closer to the end of this course, you will find the whole section about dancing with veil. It's one of the most traditional props that we use in ballet dance. But in this video, let's actually explore all kinds of props that you can use in ballet dance. And here right away I'm correcting myself, because there's multiple enormous number of props that you can involve into your ballet dance performance. But here I want to highlight some of the main props that exist in ballet dance. Right away, saying here that props, they're actually not very traditional, so you will not see much of prop use if you're talking about traditional Egyptian performances. There, they usually just keep it as a dance. Sometimes, as an entrance of the dancer, they may use some extravagant prop, but this is more something that happens now, like recently, even like 5 years ago, the only prop that actually was popular was veil, and sometimes cane for folkloric performances. But other props, like that we'll talk about in this video, they more came from dancers who decided to borrow elements from other cultures and fuse them into ballet dance, and they came into ballet dance as a show elements. So whenever you're doing a ballet dance performance, and if you have multiple songs to perform, one encouragement I always give to all students, always remember that first of all, it's a dance show. It's a dance performance. It's not a show of props. So don't try to fit like 3, 4, 5 props into your performance, even if it's a 30-minute program, because then you're transforming it into some kind of a prop show rather than actually a ballet dance performance. Usually for my performances, I will use 1 or 2 props if we are talking about a non-stop performance. Usually it will be in the beginning, so I enter with this prop, and sometimes I may prepare one prop somewhere in the corner of my stage to pick up in the middle of my show, but it will be something smaller, like maybe cane or some other small kind of prop. If I have more than just one costume during my performance, then I can, of course, use more props. So it's one prop per each entrance, let's say, each performance. In some ways, sometimes 2. But let's start with something that you will see also in this course. It's a veil. I also explained much more about veils in this separate section of this course. And there you will see a veil which is made from silk, and you can see how that one flows. This is another example of veil. So it's the same size more or less, but it's done from different materials, so it's a bit heavy and it will fly differently. The kind of work you do is sort of the same with any kind of veil, but you need just to make sure that you practice with specific veil that you are going to perform, because you may need some extra force whenever you are trying to do the same move that you practice, for instance, with a silk veil, but then you get a chiffon veil and it flows very differently. So you need to put much more effort or energy in creating the movement. One of the tricks that sometimes dancers do to make sure that they can perform with a veil at some point in their show, but not necessarily to start with it, is that they will tackle it in their skirt. So they will just get a bunch of fabric together and they will put it inside of their skirts and maybe adjust something on the back too. So in this case, they will usually choose a veil that is matching their costume color or goes together very nicely with that costume color. So when they first enter, guests or audience not necessarily know that, oh, this is a veil and dancer will use it. It more looks like a part of their costume. And then unexpectedly, at some point of their performance, they take it out and start dancing with veil. So this is one of the nice ways how to incorporate second prop in the middle of your show. And specific in this case, we are talking about veil. More about veil and how to use it, you will find again in the separate section. The only one more thing that I will add is that in Egyptian show, if you're talking about traditional Egyptian show, veils are typically used just for the entrance, and usually the dancer just will hold it behind and do a couple of rounds, maybe do a couple of moves with veil, and then put it right away down and then keep dancing. So veil is more used as a framing and just to create this grandiose entrance, spectacular presentation and first impression of dancer, but not necessarily any intricate movements with veil. This if you're talking about traditional Egyptian show. Of course, in Egypt today, there are a lot of dancers who like to fuse and experiment. So if you see some video on social media that is like, oh, this is happening in Egypt, and they actually do any crazy veil work, that's happening too. But if you're talking about traditional Egyptian ballet dance show, veil will be very simple use of this prop. Another typical prop in ballet dance is cane. So when you will see the section on folklore dancing, and specifically Saidi, cane belongs to Saidi folklore style a lot. And you not necessarily need to perform Saidi with a cane, but this is like 90% of Saidi performances. You'll see they usually will be either with cane or tahtib. Tahtib is a male version of Saidi, and it's basically just a stick without this hook. This is more a female version of it, but it is present in ballet dance too. Sometimes in ballet dance song, you can have a folkloric section, Saidi, so maybe you'll put it somewhere on the corner of your stage and then get it during some interesting flip, or you remember our full hip body circle. That's one of the moves that you can nicely pick up your cane from the floor and start dancing it with it. And sometimes it will be just holding cane either to the side like this or above your head. But sometimes you will do some certain movements, and one of the typical movements is cane rotation. So in this case, dancer holds cane between two fingers, between big finger and index finger. And you just need to train to practice to hold it here. And then the rotations can go either forward, go back, or can go diagonally. There are many different variations, but this is one of the very typical props for ballet dance. Not necessarily that you will use it with specific Saidi song, but if you have some nice upbeat pop song, and you know that music, song, and beat allows you to use cane, that it's appropriate, that it's not two completely different things, what music tells you and what history and a meaning of prop is, you can use it on some pop songs too. So this is another very typical prop. Rest, except chamadan, but chamadan I'll leave on our dessert for this video. But all other props, they are sort of a fusion kind of props that are not really typical for ballet dance. So one of them, not typical for traditional ballet dance. One of them is sword. And sword probably comes from the fantasy idea of dancers dancing with a weapon, or maybe like women saw some swords from their husbands, and then they pick them up and start dancing. But this is more comes to a fantasy idea of ballet dance. For traditional show, it's not really much typical that some Egyptian dancer, for instance, will use sword. No, not really. This is one of the show elements, but this is a very spectacular show element. So the way that dancer can use a sword, first of all, there are many different designs of sword. Like this one is super decorated. Sometimes they are much simpler. It can be gold, gold be silver, like doesn't matter. Multiple designs, as many as costume designs, there are so many designs of each prop. But one of the most spectacular moments that dancer is dancing with a sword, if of course balancing the sword. And one of the ways is to balance on your head, and then you do something with your body, hips, turns. Another way, sometimes dancer balance them on their shoulders, can be balanced on their hip, sometimes in the back bend on your chest or even in your belly during back bend. Of course, if the grip of your sword allows, you can also do rotation similar to the cane. A few things to tell. Of course, this is not a real sword. This is a theatrical prop, so it's not sharp, it won't injure anyone, but it's quite heavy. So whenever you are dancing with sword, make sure that you practice enough so that it doesn't flip from your hand or doesn't fall off your head and doesn't injure anyone around you or even you yourself, just because it's quite heavy usually. But whenever you decide that you want to buy a sword or to get a sword, of course, now there are a lot of online stores that you can get them. But one of the important things, if you're buying in person, to check if your sword is actually balanced. So you can easily find a point. Let's see if I can find it here now. That it will balance on two fingers. This is the help for you, how you can balance it later on your head or on your hip or anywhere else. It needs to be done as a theatrical prop, so don't try to get a real sword. It needs to be a theatrical sword, so prop, which is balanced. So the handle is as heavy as this part of the sword. It doesn't necessarily need to be in the middle, but it needs to be somewhere that you feel, okay, yes, this prop will balance. Otherwise, it just will be a prop that you will hold in your hand or maybe flip somehow, but that's it. If you want to actually use a sword for balancing, make sure that it's a balanced prop. An advantage, of course, for this to either buy from checked online stores that specialize in belly dance props or buy in person and check the way I just showed. So this is another kind of prop that we use in belly dance. Also, there is something that is called fans, and of course there is some typical like fans that we can imagine from all movies or all fantasies about belly dance. So this one, for instance, is done from a peacock feather, but sometimes it can be just decorated with some fabric or somehow decorated. And this one you can of course use for framing. So if I'm, for instance, do this hip, I can hold it nicely framing, or you can move it. Again, this is not really traditional Egyptian prop, but it comes more from Spanish dance, and the all work that you will do with fans like this will go more like as they use fans in Spain too. But in belly dance, they came up with some variation that is not only including fans from belly dance fantasy world or fans from a Spanish world, but also incorporates some Asian dance styles. And this kind of fan is called fan-vail. And the reason why, I have here two, so if you take one, it's basically a combination of fan and a long piece of fabric. And you can do all sorts of things with it. Again, you can just frame it. Maybe if I have two of them, for instance, I can use them as my framing, and then I dance in the middle, or I can actually move them. So I can flip them down or up, somehow around me. But this is obviously is a fantasy belly dance or fusion belly dance pieces that I will use these fan veils, unless I have a really nice upbeat and interesting beginning of my measures, a song that I feel like, oh, that would be cool to use fan veils. But typically this will be a fusion kind of belly dance, not a traditional belly dance. And there are many dancers who teach workshops with this kind of fans. They can be long, they can be short, they can be super wide, much wider and bigger than what I have here. But whenever I have these kind of props, I always encourage people, first just get it and experiment on your own and see what you can come up with, because sometimes we too much worry, oh, how it's supposed to be. All of this is sort of a fantasy pieces, props that are not traditional. There are no specific rules how you can dance with it. So you can definitely come up with your own use and technique of all these props. And if you go to someone's workshops, you can just get more tips. Pick out the brains of that dancer. Oh, she uses it in this way. I didn't think about this. But don't be scared that you need to find a separate teacher for each of prop. I usually just say, go and try and experiment and feel, see what feels good. Just closing about fan-vails, one tip how to keep them nice in your bag, then you need to store them before shows. You put either one or two together closed and you just basically wrap the fabric around them. And it's nice, compact, and you can store it. I just what usually do before I know I perform in like next day with them, I iron them because I prefer to have all fabrics having a nice visual effect and not attracting attention. Oh, this is not iron, this is wrinkled. So, but some dancers don't. It depends on the kind of fabric and pattern that you have both on your veils and on your fan veils. And see how visible it is. But for storage, this is one of the nice ways to do it. One more prop, which is involves some fabric, is called Isis wings. Here I have a triple Isis wings. Basically, I put together three pairs of wings, but most common in ballet dance world is just to have a simple pair of Isis wings. Usually, the typical ones, they're made from this kind of fabric, which is not only sparkly, but has this sort of specific pattern of the fabric. They can be different colors, gold, silver, like here I have basically three of them. And it has a wrap that you put around your neck, and then you have two huge wings on the side of your body. And each of them have a stick put inside, so you can hold the stick and you can open it. Like, let's imagine it's behind me, so it's put around my neck, and then on one side, I just hold my wing stick and I open it. Again, it can be used as a framing, so I just hold them and nicely frame me, or I can do all sorts of movements with them. What I have here is triple wings, but this is more unusual prop that I specifically use. You can go on my social media. I have a lot of videos performing with triple wings as well as just simple wings, so you can pick up some ideas for movements. The only thing I would say, whenever you are buying wings, very often you will need to change the sticks. Usually they are coming either without this kind of stick, just for shipping purposes. The sellers these days just sell fabric pieces, and then you need to find your own stick. You can buy a specialized stick from ballet dance store that is called like a stick for ballet dance Isis rings, but not necessarily. I usually prefer much thinner sticks from what they suggest in those ballet dance stores, and I buy just a piece of wood from art supply stores. Super cheap, super accessible. I can choose how thin or thick I want the stick, and I put it myself, basically wrapping around the fabric. They will have a hole already in the wings, in the design of wings itself, so you just need to put it inside and stitch to make sure that it fits and doesn't slide inside it. But that's basically it. And to choose how big you need to find stick, basically what I do is, when I put it around me again, I need to make sure that I hold it comfortably and that I can hold not only in the middle, because if you're holding it only in the middle and here's the fabric is tight, so you can't really go and hold it on the edge of your stick. If you need to hold it in the middle, it will really limit your movement. So make sure that the length of your wings in general and specific to your stick, either you're buying from Ballet and Store or just buying from any art supply store, it matches the total size of your wings. So from the middle of your wings that are close to your neck to your wrist, basically, you have just the fabric. And then here I hold by the edge of my stick, and this can allow me either to move it, or if I need, I can easily switch it to, for instance, some other position. But if I'm holding it in the middle, then basically I will limit myself a lot. So this is about Isis wings. They not necessarily need to be done with this fabric. I did one pair for myself, just designed myself, cut out and put those sticks from a silk. Sometimes they are done from chiffon. They can have even LED lights built in them. So really, Balladance world is now very creative, and designers go sometimes super crazy with all those innovations. And that's another reason why I'm saying that these props, they're just one of the main typical props. Every couple months, something new comes out on Balladance scene, and sometimes it's just a little trend that comes and goes, and sometimes they get everyone's attention, and everyone suddenly start dancing with them, and they stay as a and become a loose part of typical Balladance props. Also, here you may be questioning, why do I have drum on this table? Of course, drum is a music instrument, and we have a separate bonus video for you. There, Pedro, our drummer, will explain you everything that you need to know about drum and all sounds it can produce and how we use it in Arabic music. But sometimes it actually can be used as a prop, and dancers these days sometimes can take the drum, it can be this drum or can be a little bit bigger drum, and they stay on top of drum and dance there. Most usually it will be some kind of drum solo songs, but music instrument drum became incorporated into ballet dancing as a prop as well. That's why I keep it on this table together with other props. That it's another option. Once you develop your skills, you can actually dance on top of a drum. But again, this is a show element. You need to clearly understand to which music to do it and for which audience to do it. And make sure if you're borrowing drum from your drummer that you told him about this in advance and he's okay with you stepping on his drum. Or otherwise, just get a drum specifically for you if you actually really want to do something crazy like that. Not much about really technique or anything. You just need to be really good with your hip and belly work and be balanced in order to be able to be on a drum and dance. And one of the dancers who I highly encourage you to search on Google, his name is Tito. It's a male dancer. He is Egyptian, and he is doing amazing things specifically with the drum, with the idea of standing on the drum. And on this, I'll leave you to search and be intrigued what can be done on top of the drum. The last prop that I have here today on this table with me is called chamadan. So chamadan, I'll put for now on top of my drum. Imagine this is a dancer. But chamadan is basically comes from a folkloric tradition of weddings. It's more like a wedding traditions that had something called zafas. And zafas, it's a wedding procession. Their bride in villages comes from her parents' house to her new home with a groom and his family. And the idea of Zafa processions is that there are two aspects. One is that groom hires a music band and dancers to cheer up bride's family, who may be sad on the last day of all celebrations that their daughter is leaving their home and goes away, although maybe happy for her marriage, but it's still daughter leaving the house. So the idea is that the groom we are talking about traditional weddings in old times or in villages, that the groom hires a music band to cheer up bride's family. And another idea of Zafa is that when bride goes from parents' house to her new home, musicians and dancers who accompany her, accompany the procession, they create a specific music and beat that basically tells everyone in the village that the wedding is happening and now bride is going to her new home. So traditionally, the dancers who accompany the procession very often were holding big candles in their hands while they were walking and dancing together with the group. And the reason for that was very practical, because usually that was happening in the evenings. So they were basically lighting and giving some light for the road and for people to go past this way. But later, going through show element, incorporating this element into cabaret shows for ballet dancers, all this idea got transformed into what today is known as shamadan. So it's basically the way to hold candles on your head and still be able to dance. And today this is very typical for weddings, for Zafa entrances. Of course, in the modern world and in the cities, we don't have music bands coming with bride from her apartment to your new apartment with the groom. But Zafas today, they basically identify first entrance to the banquet hall or wherever the wedding celebration comes of bride and groom as a married couple. So they already got married and now it's a part of the day that it's just celebration, and their first entrance to that room is what today is called Zafa entrance. It can be just bride and groom walking in with their favorite song, or it can be accompanied with the drummers and dancers, and dancers can have shamadans on top of their heads. Not necessarily can be just dancer without shamadans, but this is one of the typical uses of shamadan. Also, shamadan can be used as a show element. So it's not necessarily only at the weddings or only to Zafa songs or wedding songs. It can be used as a just show element. It can be used in some folkloric songs, can be used in some more modern songs or some ballad and fantasy songs, as I explained in another video what I mean by that. It's very theatrical, it's very spectacular. It can use regular, real candles. It can be with the fake candles. Also, whenever you're performing, make sure that the venue that you're performing at, they are okay with you holding candles on your head, because sometimes managers of restaurants or event spaces, they get a little bit nervous seeing this very unusual dancer's appearance with this shamadan hand on the top of her head. But usually it's very fun and very very spectacular thing. And the construction of shamadan is pretty simple. It's basically candle holders that hold the candles, and a hat which basically you put it around your forehead like this. So it's pretty stable. You just need to make sure that all details of shamadan connected properly and they are not wobbly in its construction, but on your head it's pretty stable. And then your arms are free and you can walk with it, you can dance with it. The only caution that I always say, be careful with people around and be ready that if you are using a regular real candles, once the wax start melting, if they're not really centered, if they're slightly tilted to the side, any sharp movement and the wax can go down. So sometimes you need to get ready that it can get on your skin. It's not much painful, it's just like 1 second and then it's done. But you just need to be aware that that can happen. And don't forget, still smile and don't show everyone around what happened. But if you have other people around you, especially kids, make sure that they don't they don't come too close to you because that wax can go on them, and they are definitely not ready for that kind of surprise. So here are some of the typical belly dance props. Of course, there are many, many, many more, and you can just search on video on YouTube, on Google, belly dance, and you'll probably see not only typical belly dance performance just as a dancer, but you will see a lot of videos, dancers holding some kind of props and incorporating them in their dance. So I highly encourage you to experiment, start with some typical props that you can find a lot of tutorials on, and later just go into something that first of all makes you excited about their use and incorporating in your dance, and don't be afraid to get creative.